How many humans will it take to build it? What will happen to the effects of the planet's low gravity? And will it be ruled by any country on Earth, or will it have its own government? In today's video, we will find out. The dream of living in another world. For many years, humanity and the most enthusiastic scientists have dreamed up the possibility of someday to build a city on the planet Mars. From the first science fiction stories of the adventures of John Carter to the discovery of the canals of Percival Lowell, who believed that there was an extraterrestrial civilization on the red planet that had built water channels to distribute the vital liquid to all the population. The idea of being able to populate our red neighbor has always been on everyone's mind. But it hasn't been until now that we can glimpse a slight possibility of making that dream a reality. Is it possible to establish ourselves on Mars? Since the 60s, scientists and space agencies worldwide began to send the first space exploration probes to Mars. The first mission to successfully reach the orbit of the red planet was the Mariner 4 exploration probe, which passed just 6,120 miles from Mars and sent 22 photos to Earth, with which we had sharp images for the first time in the history of our neighbor. However, these images disappointed many dreamers who expected to see forests and oceans on Mars, as the photos only showed an arid, dry planet with no signs of life. Since the arrival of the Mariner 4 probe to the current date, a total of 51 missions to Mars have been sent, of which only a third have been successful. That is, in more than 60 years, less than 20 missions have managed to reach the orbit of the Martian surface successfully. Those missions have been enough to gather a lot of information about the red planet that helps us better understand how the geology of the planet was developed, what the conditions are that prevail there, and many other important discoveries, such as the fact that on Mars there is frozen water at the poles. There may also be water below the surface. We currently have the following data on Mars. Number 1. It has a radius of 2,106 miles and is 3 times smaller than the Earth, which has a radius of 6,093 miles. Number 2. The duration of the day equals 1 Earth day plus 37 minutes. The day is very similar in length to that on Earth. Number 3. The force of gravity. The attraction of Mars' gravitational pull is 1/3 of the Earth's and equals 3,721 meters squared. Number 4. Temperatures range from 68 degrees Fahrenheit during the day to minus 196 degrees Fahrenheit at night. In general, it is much colder than Earth. Number 5. Mars does not have a magnetic field. The solar wind reaches the surface with great intensity, wiping out all organic matter. Number 6. There is a lot of methane in its atmosphere, and the air of Mars is not breathable. Number 7. The atmospheric pressure varies greatly depending on the year's season, reaching such low levels that the ice at its poles sublimates. That is, it passes from the solid state to the gaseous state instantaneously, without going through a liquid state. All these conditions make us realize that the conditions are extreme on Mars, and any human being who planted himself on the surface without the protection of a spacesuit would die in minutes. It would not be possible to establish a city on Mars if all these problems were not solved first. Requirements for the first city on Mars. The first city of Mars will have to overcome many obstacles and challenges that no one has ever faced. Some of the problems to solve before establishing the first city are: Number 1. Water. Without water, there is no life. This has always been the case. On Mars there is water, but it is not available for consumption because it is frozen at the poles or hidden many meters underground. Although this is not a problem, as there are many methods to obtain water. Some of the methods that could be used by the first astronauts, who will lay the foundations of a future Martian city, are melting. For this, we would only have to obtain frozen water at the poles and melt it with heat. Yes, we would have to do this procedure inside a spacecraft or space capsule, since because of the low pressure of the atmosphere on Mars, it would evaporate instantly otherwise. Extraction. We could also extract it and store the water in vacuum-sealed containers. Carry it from Earth. As contradictory as this sounds, perhaps the most viable option at first will be to carry the water from the ground and reuse all the body fluids, such as sweat and urine, to produce more water as the International Space Station does. Number 2. Air. Once the water problem has been solved, we would have to solve the air problem. For this, we could rely on the Martian air. On Mars, 95% of the atmosphere is composed of carbon dioxide. And do you know what things produce oxygen from carbon dioxide? Exactly, the plants. If we can plant plants on the surface of protected Mars within a habitat where high temperatures do not harm them, we could inject air from the outside loaded with carbon dioxide so that the plants could produce oxygen. Number 3. Magnetic field. Perhaps this is one of the most challenging problems to solve. At first, astronauts going to Mars could shelter from high doses of radiation inside capsules or inside an underground room. Still, if over time we want to build a city on the Red Planet, we will have to have some method to protect everyone from radiation. On Earth, what protects us from solar flares and solar wind is the magnetic field that the Earth has due to the movement of the iron core that is in the center of the planet. Mars does not have a similar field, so the only way to protect ourselves would be to build an artificial magnetic field around the entire planet. Many ideas have been proposed to achieve this, but so far, the most realistic seems to be the idea of a research team of Dr. Jim Green of NASA. They propose that a solution to the absence of a magnetic field on Mars could be to build a high-power magnetic dipole and place it at the Martian Lagrange L1 point, the position at which an object would remain in orbit around the Sun in sync with the orbit of Mars. In the video about the James Webb Telescope, we talk briefly about the Lagrange points, but in short, these are areas of space where the combined gravitational attraction of two massive bodies generate a balance point where objects can stay there indefinitely. Each planet has 5 Lagrange points concerning the Sun. Dr. Green states that this magnetic dipole would form a magnetopause, that is, a magnetic tail that would envelop the entire red planet, reducing the radiation and the effect of the solar wind to allow a new atmospheric balance that would protect humans on the surface and allow the process of building cities. The first city. Undoubtedly, all these challenges will sooner or later be solved. Once it is achieved, the few astronaut colonies that have successfully settled on the surface of Mars will be ready to receive more people who are ready to build the first city. The first city on Mars will probably be built near the first astronaut settlements. The exact location is not yet clear, but indeed, a place will be sought where the day and night temperatures are not so high, where the storms are not so intense, and above all, where there is some deposit of water that we can provide. The first city will be built with the same technology that will be used to build the bases on the Moon, and with materials very similar to those that can cover the spacecraft, capable of withstanding the planet's harsh conditions, and where people can be safe. The astronauts' stay on Mars will not be permanent, as low gravity conditions will eventually cause severe damage to the bones and muscles of the body. So every astronaut who goes to Mars to work on building the city would have a time limit and then return to the Earth to recover. Every so often, a new fleet of astronauts would arrive, who would be responsible for replacing those on Mars to return to Earth. At first, the missions will be carried out every 26 months, because this is the time it takes for Earth and Mars to reach their point of maximum approximation. But as spacecraft perfect themselves and become faster and faster over the years, the time it would take for Earth's journey to Mars gets shorter and shorter, going from several months to a couple of weeks. After a few decades, as more astronauts arrive in large numbers, the city on Mars will begin to take shape. Due to the low force of gravity of the planet, it will be much easier to make large constructions, and we will form huge cupolas of tens of hundreds of kilometers where humans can live without the need for a spacesuit, just like on Earth. The arrival of more plants and animals would help make an increasingly self-sustaining colony. The maximum use of water would allow extended stays on the planet without the need to return to Earth. The effects of gravity. As we already mentioned, the gravity of Mars is only a third of that on Earth. At first, this will be a big problem, since astronauts will not be able to adapt to this in any way. It has been shown that even astronauts who remain in good physical condition exercising on the ISS still show severe damage to their muscles and bones. Although it is impossible to predict, many analysts think that it is likely that in the future we will find a way to adapt to the low gravity of Mars. Perhaps the only way is by modifying DNA or with a natural selection that gives better capabilities to future babies born to couples living on Mars. For now, it is not possible to predict how we will combat this problem. But what is certain is that somehow we will have to do it. Martian government. What laws will be obeyed on Mars? Will there be a government that tells astronauts what to do? Or will astronauts be free to do as they please? Initially, astronauts arriving on Mars will be controlled entirely by the space agencies and governments of which they are a part. If there is a Japanese astronaut on Mars, the direct head of this astronaut will be the Japanese Space Agency, as the Japanese government. But what will happen to astronauts born on Mars? What will happen when all the people on Mars are born on that planet and none were ever on Earth? To which government will they belong? This is not a simple question to answer. An easy rule could be that people born on Mars will have the same nationality as their parents. But what if both parents had different nationalities? In theory, parents should decide their child's nationality before they die. At first, things will likely be very similar to what happens in Antarctica. In Antarctica, there are very different research missions where scientists worldwide live daily inside small camps that protect them from the harsh, inclement weather. Although many parts of the world are at war or conflict, in Antarctica, these conflicts do not interfere with daily work since people are busy trying not to die of cold. In the first city of Mars, something similar should happen. Although everyone will have different nationalities, no matter how many wars take place on Earth, each inhabitant of the Red Planet will have a task to fulfill and will not have time to worry about the political conflicts that occur on Earth. But what will happen many decades later when many people live on Mars and are all of different nationalities? Which government will answer for them? Will there be a possibility that all governments will agree to intervene in what happens on another planet? In this scenario, it is likely that the Martians, that is, the people born on Mars, with time, will cease to depend on the government on Earth and begin to govern themselves, establishing their own rules and their own Martian government. Now, what do you think? Which of those scenarios do you think will be the most difficult for people who have to build the first city on Mars to solve? Let us know your opinion in the comments section below.